have passed on, they are the only ones who can answer the unanswered questions. People like JonBenet Ramsey, the 6-year-old beauty queen, Nicole Brown Simpson, who stabbed her to death that night in her front courtyard, Ennis Cosby, shot and killed because he was in the wrong place at the wrong time. Is that what happened? Kurt Cobain, suicide, or was it? The list goes on and on to even the recent Swiss Air victims. Wouldn't you want to talk to these people to find out what their final hours were like? They're the only ones who really know. The mystery of the people who have passed over, they've got the answers, or at least we like to think that they do. Joining us today is author and spiritual medium, Rosemary Altea. Now, Rosemary, it's good to see you again. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Rosemary's book is a good read. This book, Proud Spirit, she talked about this the last time she was here, and shortly after your appearance here, you got on the bestseller list. So people...
New York Times bestseller. But
yes, which is a biggie. People are fascinated and interested.
Thank you.
Now, we had our show planned out before. We had guests that were trying to reach people on the other side. We were stunned when the show that we had planned to present to you didn't really happen because we aren't producing The World Beyond. There were people who wanted to get through and talk to folks like you out in the audience, and we were stunned when that happened. Here's just a bit of it.
Do you mind if I come up there?
Whatever.
I don't know. Okay.
You told us that this may happen, that somebody up here may be trying to get through.
I don't know where I'm going yet because I'm connecting with someone who took their own life. He's just describing how he just, you know, can I come up here? I'm sorry.
You may. It's what you're here for.
Do you know what I'm talking about?
Well, a friend of mine.
Hang on, let me get a mic to you, please.
I knew him.
Stand up.
He was like 19 years old. He hung himself.
Okay.
Like probably like 2 weeks ago.
Now, wait a minute. Wait a minute. You came right over to her.
I just know
I don't
that
know
I'm
you. Do you
somewhere.
Know Rosemary?
No, I don't know her.
I have a young man here, a little boy, who is standing to my left here. Hold me tight. Hold me tight. I'm asking him, does he want to speak to me? And he's nodding furiously, but he really doesn't want to speak to me. He wants to speak to you guys. And you must be connected here as well. Are you sis? Are you sis? He's calling you sis. She's my sis.
Are you?
And,
yes.
Oh my gosh, I didn't even know you two came together.
Yeah.
I didn't even know these stories belong together. Now, it was an amazing moment, and the photographs that we put in there, we put in after the show because they had brought them with them in their pockets, but we didn't know that those people were going to be a part of the program. You never know what's going to happen, do you?
I never know. It's always a surprise to me. I'm so glad I didn't wear the same suit today that I wore on that clip that you're showing. I always brought it with me. I never know what's going to happen.
But just for people who aren't familiar with this, and there are always skeptics, and clearly Rosemary says you're invited to believe what you choose to believe. There's no way for us to prove it or for her to prove that it's real necessarily. But how does it work?
That's a big question. I'm not really sure how it works. For me, I've always been psychic. I hate to use that word, but I've always seen people in the spirit world. I've always heard voices, seen faces, and been able to contact the spirit world. From being a very small child, I was able to do this. And
weren't
it was
you
very
scared?
Scary.
As a
terrified,
little
terrified. And my grandmother also used to hear voices. My grandmother Eliza died when I was 6 weeks old. And she'd been a voluntary patient in the local psychiatric hospital in the city of Leicester in England, where I was born. And my mother, as I was growing up, seeing the same traits in me that she'd seen in her own mother, would say to me, "You'll end up like your grandma in the towers." And it was a threat.
In the loony bin.
In the loony bin. It was a threat to me to behave. And I grew up with this until I was in my very early 30s. I grew up with this threat and truly believed myself to be crazy because I did see people and I did hear voices and I did have extremely strange experiences.
But how do they come through? For instance, we talked about the famous people who have died in these celebrated cases that grab the headlines where we still don't know JonBenet. So many unanswered questions. Have any people like that tried to come through and give answers or guide you to helping investigations?
Yes, and I have worked with the police, and I work with the police in Europe from time to time. I'm writing a book at the moment, and part of the theme is, why don't the investigators come to people like myself and at least try us out? Even if you're skeptical, we can maybe help. You know, the TWA Flight 800, they mm-hmm. spent millions and millions of taxpayer dollars and goodness knows how many months of investigation, and they came up with nothing. Mm-hmm. I was in a lecture hall somewhere in the West, was able to give someone a message from their brother who had been killed in the TWA Flight 800. And the brother described how there was first a smell of burning and then an explosion. If we'd have gone on with that, who knows where we'd have got with that, and who knows how we could help investigators. There are no guarantees. I can't say, yes, we can show you exactly what happened. I can't guarantee that someone from the spirit world is going to come and talk to me. I don't know why some don't. I don't know why many do. As I'm sitting here, can I do something? I've sort of started already.
Yes, you're there now.
Thank you.
You think we're going to go to commercial now?
Well, I have a young man who is extremely handsome, who is standing by the side of you. He's talking to me about your earrings. And he's saying something about a one earring, a very special one earring, which he's wearing. He says, you know what he's talking about. He tells me he was very sick before he died. And he tells me he died of AIDS. He was very, very sick. You all right? I mean, don't do this to me. You're the host of the show.
Wait a minute. What you have to know is I said to my production.
No, you don't have to know anything. Don't tell me anything yet. Don't tell me anything yet. He's talking to me about your husband, and he's talking about the babies, not just one baby. I don't know how many babies you have here, but he's talking about the babies. And he wants to give a message to your husband. And the message is, he's standing there so proud, and he's pointing to his earring, and he says, see, I still wear it. And he's laughing, and he says, you see, tell him, I told him so. You were just perfect for each other. You were just perfect. And he takes all the credit.
He should take all the credit.
And he wants you to know he's not sick anymore. It's all gone. He says, tell them I can breathe again. Tell them I'm not sick. Tell them I can walk. And I don't, he says, I shook. I just couldn't stop shaking towards the end. Tell them I'm steady as a rock.
My friend Troy, last night, I said a prayer as I was rocking my baby to sleep. And I said, Troy, we're doing this show with this Rosemary. Now, I know you're busy. I know you're busy up there throwing parties. And I told my staff, didn't I? I told them this morning, I said to my friend Troy, if you can break away, come down here. Because when my baby was born, I named him Troy, was the last time I heard from him. And he sent a rainbow. And you're right, Steve is perfect for me. He was our matchmaker. He introduced me to my husband. I can't believe this.
He's right, because he says the earring.
And the earring, he gave me these special earrings, and I lost one.
Well, he's wearing it. Maybe he stole
my gosh.
It. Maybe he took it with him. You know, they do
Troy.
That. They do that.
All right, the show is not about me, but I'm so grateful to you.
He has a final message, because I know we have to get on with everything else, but the final message is, and he says this, and he's very emotional, he's crying, but he's so happy he finally got through to you, and he says, just tell them, all of them, everyone out there, tell them I'm alive, tell them we're alive, we are alive.
Well, I never had any doubts about that. We have so many guests today, all I can tell you is, I hope for you that the person that you want to talk to is as clear as my friend Troy. Oh my goodness. They have all come, Rosemary. They have unanswered questions. They've lost people. John Green has been on the show many times before. John wants to know about his missing daughter, Kimmy. Diane and Elena, about the mysterious death of their runaway teen. Suzanne is here.
Do you have a pad and a pen?
A sketch pad, yes, we do.
Can I have it, please?
Suzanne, her son was murdered, doesn't know if someone was out for him or if it was mistaken identity. And then Shirley and Tracy want to know who on earth would kill a pregnant mom while her 14-month-old toddler was there to watch it all. What do you need this for?
Oh, I'm just going to play with it. I don't know, actually. All right. Take no notice of me. Carry on.
I hope this is a good sign that the people over there on the other side want to get through today.
I don't know.
We've only got an hour. Let me get on with it. Murder Mysteries from Beyond. Come on back. Rosemary Altea is here. We've asked John Green to join her up on stage. I'm going to let them take it because I'm still a little bit shocked by what she just told me. But you're sketching something. Does this have to do with John's missing daughter?
I don't know yet. I don't know what I'm really doing yet, so I'm just going to be talking my way through it and hoping that I'm inspired enough to figure out what I'm doing. First of all, I'm seeing mountains. I don't know actually where you live or where you, you know, where you come from, but there's some sort of a mountain area or mountain region.
Yes.
Is that right?
Yes.
And I'm seeing also in the mountain somehow some sort of a shack which looks to me like a mining shack or a miner's shack, or I don't know if there are, anyway.
Yes.
Does that mean something?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. And as I'm talking to you, I keep glimpsing this bright light, and I know she's somewhere around, and I just wanted to say hello to her. She's waving at me here.
While you're working, Rosemary, let me roll a videotape that we've prepared because we want the audience to know some about John's story.
Okay.
And Kimmy that you have not seen, but here's the tape. You may have heard his story before on our show.
Something terrible's happened to Kimmy.
John Green's daughter, Kimmy, disappeared 2 years ago, leaving behind two precious little girls. Her husband said she went to the store and never came home. John believes his daughter was murdered. Was it someone she knew? How did it happen? John won't rest until he knows what Kimmy's final hours were like.
Okay, that, I'm sorry, but that really distracted me.
Okay.
What I was going to say to you next was actually that I feel that this young girl is missing, and I now know anyway that it, you know, I wanted to have this big revelation here, but obviously it isn't a revelation. You know that.
It's been almost 2 years.
But I'm seeing a young girl, very pretty, darkish. She seems darkish hair. She's just standing there very quietly, not saying too much. She's talking about there must be two girls or two children. Are there two children? And they seem to be, she keeps saying to you over and over again that they're protected, they're protected. Would you please stop worrying about them? They're protected. They are safe. They are safe. There seems to be a great concern about the children and where they are and what they're doing.
Can I interrupt to say why that is, John? You've cried a lot of tears on my stage about those kids.
It's my granddaughters.
Okay, hold my hand. Okay, all right, hold tight now. I feel that there's some connection to the mountains, to some sort of a mining shack. I'm guessing it's a mining shack, but it looks very much like an old miner's shack. And she's saying it's somehow up and in. Up, not all the way to the top of the mountains, but somehow part way up and in the mountains. And there's one big mountain, there's one really big mountain, which she says is close to home, or close to where home used to be. Am I making any sense
yes,
to you?
Ma'am.
And she's talking about digging, and hidden here.
Have they looked for
and
her?
And she's talking about clues and finding clues in this region here. Does that make any sense?
We originally started all of our searches in mine shafts. That was kind of where the investigation began, and I think everybody thought we were nuts. And I mean, Fred Salazar helped me with
Fred? Wave at me. Hi, Fred.
He's anxious for any clues. He's worked on this case from the beginning. Now, what do mine shafts have to do with anything?
Well, when John Green first approached me, he indicated to me that Kimmy was possibly buried in a mine shaft. And northwest of Alamos, Colorado, is a mining town, old mining town known as La Garita in Sawatch County. And Sawatch County Sheriff's Office dive team accompanied John and I, and we searched several mines, vertical mines, horizontal mines, mines filled with water, and to no avail.
But you say this is near?
It seems to be, there's I'm seeing an old mining shack, which is, you know, very close to the mountains. It seems to me to be in the mountains, close to a particularly tall mountain, a large mountain. I know all the mountains in Colorado are tall, so it's really, you know, I didn't realize it was Colorado.
Out of respect to them, excuse me, I'm going to let them continue. If we can just quietly go to commercial break, we will rejoin as they're discussing. So we'll be right back. Keep talking.
She's talking about beyond where you live, or beyond where it would normally be. Does that make any sense to you? She says that people came in from outside, they tromped around, and then they went, then they left. Does that make any sense to you?
So there were lots of investigators and police on this location?
It's like,
Have I been there? Will she tell you, have I been there?
Don't ask me any questions just for a second. Let me just, I don't know how you deal with this from day to day, but I just want her to talk to me, and she keeps talking to me. She's actually talking to me about, this is going to sound really crazy, but what looks to me like a yellow car. Is there any connection to a yellow vehicle or a bright colored vehicle?
I don't know of yellow.
It looks like a maybe you'd call it tan, I'd call it. It's not as yellow as this, but it's like a tan color or a... looks
taxi?
Like a yellow
taxi
or
taxi cab.
I don't know. All I'm seeing is, I'll just do it. All I'm seeing is a yellow car. I'm just going to put it down. Yellow car. There's a big question mark as to. As I'm seeing a man here. There's some connection to him and this car. I don't know what the connection is. There's some connection to him and the car.
Is she telling you who the man is?
No, not yet. I'm hearing a name which sounds like Al, or could be Alan. The initial A is very clear. And I'm seeing what looks like a big spade or a big shovel. And it's dirt, but it's stones and dirt. I don't think, I could be wrong here, but I don't see her going down a mine shaft.
It was not an accident?
No.
It was not an accident.
No.
This is what John has wrestled with, is did she suffer? Was this someone that she knew?
She tells me that it was, she's nodding when you ask that. Yes, it was someone that she knew. She's nodding about that. Then she's saying to me, she's talking, I don't know how many details to give you here, and I'm not infallible, but I'm not infallible. You have to understand, I'm not infallible. You know, I get it wrong too. But
everyone here today knows that, Rosemary.
Well, I just have to make it clear.
Yes.
And so I do think that it was very quick. She's talking about her neck and she's talking about her throat. And I think that there was a fight. I think there was a big fight. And it was, you know, very fast, very quick. You can say it was an accident. I do not think it was deliberate murder. I do not think it was deliberate.
It went too far.
It went too far. Whoever this man is has a temper and cannot control his temper. He wants what he wants, what he wants. And
John, I
also feel that she knows him and that she knows him well. I do feel that. I do feel that. Then when I say this, I'm asking her, as I'm talking to you, I'm asking her, you know, is there anything that she wants to say? And she really would like to talk more about her children than anything else. This is her main concern. And she's asking me to say to you, she's stroking your hair and you've had it cut. You've just had it cut, she says. And she's stroking your hair and she's over and over again, she says, Dad, Dad. And she tells me that these kids, it's like there's been a wall put around them and you feel that you can't get into them. It's hard for you, you just can't get into them. You can't seem to find a way through.
He's been denied access to them.
Well, legally, they cannot deny you access anyway, whoever this is, so go for it. I mean, legally, you know, you just have to fight for this.
But is there an angel looking over them? Who's protecting them?
She is their angel. This is what she wants to say. And she's saying, I'm their mother, but I'm their angel. I am their angel. She feels that it's time to let go of her. You can never, as a parent, let go of your child, but you have to. There comes a point in your life when you have to let go of the search for her, because, you know, It's often the case those in the spirit world will say to us, I'm not in that grave. You can go and you can take flowers and you can put flowers on my grave and then you walk away and we walk away with you. And who gets the flowers? Nobody gets the flowers. I know you want closure of some kind. You want to find your child. I know that's important to you. But what's important to her, darling, is that your efforts and that your energy are centered around these girls, that you do the best you can for them. Because she is in a safe place. She is with God. She is in a place where there, she says, tell him I'm in a place where there is light. Tell him I'm in a place where there is joy. Your grandchildren's teeth needs fixing. I mean, I guess, do you know that they should be at the dentist? They may even be at the dentist. It's a little thing that she's telling you that says, I'm watching every move they make. I'm there with them all the time. And over she says, you're so afraid that something is going to happen to them. And she says, tell him that they are safe.
I want him to have answers on this one so much. We feel like he's part of our family, Rosemary. And let me just say, John, that Rosemary is has offered to everybody today to spend
the
time afterwards.
You can all come
back. To spend time afterwards if you think that we're on a path here that's helpful. The worst thing is just to cut it off here and move on. But we're going to see if there's anyone else who can get through with our other guests or anybody else in the audience. So we'll take a quick break. I'll see you right back. We've asked some other guests to join Rosemary on stage, and since the videotape packages were distracting to her, we will not play those throughout the show. But if the people at home watching see some tape, it will come in. We'll put it in after we're finished today, just to give you some information about the stories. So,
I'm actually fine if you want to play the tape. I know I'm being difficult now, but if you want to play the tapes, I'm fine.
Okay, then let's do. And Diana and Elena, if it's okay, I'd like to share with the audience a little bit of the story about your loss.
As if having your child run away from home isn't devastating enough, Diane had to then identify her 16-year-old daughter's decomposed body after a fisherman found her submerged in a river. Now, Tammy Ann Gifford is gone forever. But so many unanswered questions remain and continue to haunt her family. Why did Tammy run away? Who would have hurt her? And is there anything her family could have done to prevent her death?
Call me tight. Before we came back on air during the break, I looked at these people and I said to, I've forgotten your name, darling, to Diane. Are you the lady with the daughter who took her bag and ran away? And she nodded, right?
Yes.
I think that the first thing I have to say is I do have this young lady here. She's actually standing right between the two of us, right here. And I think that you said something on the videotape about she's gone or she doesn't have a life or something like that. And she was saying very, very determinedly, you know what a determined child this is. She was saying very determinedly, that's not true. I have a life. I'm alive. I'm here. I'm here. And why did she run away? I'm asking her, and I do feel that she was afraid. I do feel that she was involved in some sort of situation and she was afraid. I do not think that she ran away from you. I do not think she was afraid of you. I think she needed to escape. Do you understand?
Yes, I do.
Okay. I think she got mixed up with a crowd and she didn't know how to deal with it. And the only thing she knew was to pack a bag and get out of town, you know?
You
give herself
her
a break.
Didn't you, Elaine?
Yes.
And you knew she was supposed to be in school.
Yeah. It was later than when she should have been gone.
Has that made it hard for you because you didn't say anything to her?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Let me say this, and this is very hard for us to accept, for any of us who've had a loss. It's really an awful thing to hear, but it's the truth. There is nothing you could have done. It was her time. That's the worst thing to hear. When somebody in the spirit world says, it was my time, you say, well, why? And the only answer I can give you is, because God decides. And boy, have you been yelling at God, you know?
For 10 years.
She says, you have been yelling at God, and how could you do it? And how could you take my child? And she says, you have been in such torment and such turmoil, and she talks about how you've taken all of the blame of her passing onto yourself. But it was her time. It was her time. And I know that's so hard to accept, but she had finished her life here on this earth. You know, there's more to me and the work that I do and the books that I write and the... There's more to spiritualism, to life after death, than just talking to those who have died. It's a bigger subject. Why was it her time? Because she came here to this earth for an experience, a life experience. She came here to learn and to grow.
Once more, excuse us, the break is ours. The talk will continue on stage, all right? Keep talking, Rosemary.
And she's really upset with you guys. She's very upset with you. She has given you so many signs, you know.
Now you can hold it again. We are asking Rosemary to try and focus on Suzanne's story now. Suzanne's still a little unsure about this, aren't you?
Just a little.
Yeah. Well, it's as much as I know you want answers, this is a real unknown area. What are your feelings?
My feelings are, was he in the wrong place at the wrong time? Could I have did anything to prevent his death?
Well, I have two people here. I have a young man who is busy telling me how handsome he is, and he's laughing about it. He's a great personality. He tells me he was killed. I also have an older man. And he's laughing and telling me how handsome he is, too. This man was not killed. This man died actually quite suddenly and quite quickly. He's standing with his arm around your son. So you have your son and this, I don't know who this other guy is.
His grandfather died.
Well, I could have said that, but I wasn't sure. But they've come together. Mm-hmm. And your son is laughing at me a little bit, and he's saying, you know, you just said to me a few minutes ago that you were scared. He said, you should try it from our end. We're really terrified. And he's laughing. He's teasing. He's teasing. But he is very nervous because he knows what this means to you. Mm-hmm. Was he in the right place at the right time? The wrong place at the wrong time, you said. He says, the right place at the right time. And he holds his hand up because it sounds so brutal for me to say that. And I'm asking, can he explain? He's playing with your hair. He says, tell her I chose her. She taught me so much. You have a very special and a very wonderful relationship.
We did.
It was closer than mother and son. I know there's no such thing as closer than mother and son or mother and daughter, but it was closer, he says. He was in the right place at the right time because when he came here, he chose to be here for only a certain amount of time, a certain amount of learning.
Was it an accident? Did someone have it out for him?
I don't feel that it was an accident, but I do feel he got mixed up in a whole group of people, and I do not think that it was he who was meant to be harmed.
It was.
Someone else who was meant to be harmed.
Does that mean something to you, Suzanne?
Yes, he was at the wrong place at the wrong time,
no.
They say.
He was at the right place at the right time.
In the back.
But it wasn't meant for him. He says, it wasn't meant for me. The bullet was not meant for me. it was meant for someone else. You would say he got in the way. He would say, God put me there because it was my time to go. And he says, tell her, I'm in such a special place and a wonderful place. And he's laughing and he says, will you tell her I'm an angel? And he's laughing, he says his halo slipped a little.
I feel so rude interrupting, and unfortunately we have to, but they'll keep talking and we will see you back here. More with Rosemary Alte in just a moment. Came out and asked anybody out here if they had people they wanted to connect with, and of course immediately a bunch of hands went up. Rosemary, is it okay with you if we...
It is. I do have one. May I, if I can, I'm not sure where I'm going. If I can just say that I'm, this is probably so general, but I have a young man who here who was killed in a motorbike accident. And it was like so fast, so quick, so sudden, it was bang. And it was over and done with. He's laughing. I know that it's you that I'm with. Can I do this? Is this all right?
Rosemary, please do.
He's saying, take your hat off. He's laughing,
stand
take
up.
Your hat off. You don't have to, you don't have to. He says, yes, you do, yes, you do. He would like to give you a message, and I hope that this makes some sense to you. He's talking about the turmoil in your life right now, your own life and your own personal turmoil. And he says you've been very, very unsettled and talking about changing your life. Do you understand him saying this? You just want to just get up, get out, go somewhere, do something, anything other than what you're doing right now. He says you're so depressed and in such a deep hole about your life. And he says very, very plainly, he's a very plain speaker, this young man. You know, every time I've spoken to a young man, they tell me how handsome they are. But he says, you know, just tell her this.
How old was your brother?
19.
And he says, boy, do you need a kick up the backside. I told you he was a plain speaker. You really are a pain. He says, you're being a pain. You have so little confidence in yourself right now. And you're so down on yourself right now. He says, will you just stop it? He's struggling. He has the best personality. He's so great. He says, how can I be your angel if you don't listen? How can I guide you if you don't listen?
This all makes sense to you, doesn't
yeah.
it?
He says, I'm right here. I'm right with you. I'm not going to leave you. There's no way I'm going to leave you. He just says, please, will you just settle down, stay put for a while until you know where you want to be. Stay put. And he says, you must have been thinking about studying or training or doing something. He says, that's the way to go. That's the way to go.
What
but can you just
for?
Do it, you know, slowly?
Yeah, I just have been considering a pretty big career change and a move, and just kind of happened all of a sudden that I was really serious about it.
And it means that you've got to train for something and you've got to go,
right.
you know, and it's you're taking a big risk.
Yeah.
And he says, just calm down and do it slowly, plan it. You know, he says you get yourself all in a muddle with your head.
Now, if he's her angel, will he help her?
No, he says, how can I help her? She doesn't listen. Yes, he'll help you. You know he's there. You know he's with you.
I'm going to take some questions while we're in commercial break, Rosemary, okay?
We do have to listen to our love. You understand? You understand?
Yes, ma'am.
You darling.
We had no way of knowing this would happen, but Rosemary really connected with this family.
I know it's hard, but help me and help her. She describes a choking sensation, but she says it was really very fast. It was really very quick. But she's talking about her boy. Her baby boy.
She was 8 months pregnant.
Well, she says, I took him with me. I took him with me. And we're safe. We are safe.
Now, Rosemary, excuse me, I have to tell the audience because I know your story. This young mother had the 14-month-old son and was pregnant. And I believe that before she was buried, they took the unborn child and put the baby on her chest.
Yes.
And you said that she's telling them that she took the baby with her.
She took the baby with her.
Yes.
But she's describing, she wants you to know that it was very fast. She's describing a real choking sensation, a feeling of not being able to breathe. This was not an illness, you know, it
yes.
was, but It was, she says, she just wants you to know that it was really very fast. She really didn't know what was happening until it was, you know, until it was happening. Mm. And then it was really brief. She also is describing this to me because she feels that you really need to know this. I want you to listen to me really carefully. This is a really important message from her. First, the choking sensation. Not being able to breathe. Some sort of ringing in her ears, she describes. It was momentary. It was a very brief moment. Then she's describing an incredible heat. And I saw some sort of a real warmth. And her eyes were closed, and suddenly she opened her eyes, and she found herself moving in a bright light. Moving very fast, very fast, very fast, in a very, very bright light. Then a crowd of people. She was so excited. She couldn't believe it. She didn't know what to do. She says, I was so excited. I was going home. I was going home. Home is with God. Home is that place that we call heaven. Home is in your hearts, too.
And we'll be right back.
She has never left home. She has never left your hearts.
Rosemary continues to work with some presence that has his hand on a shoulder of someone in our audience, and we can't really figure out what the connection is right now. There are some guests who came here today looking for answers. They are going to have time with Rosemary after the show to see if they can connect with the person that they lost who's on the other side. If this interests you, if you think that you are a believer, if you have questions, Rosemary does have a couple of books out. The most recent one is called Proud Spirit. That one's at bookstores. If you need more information, you can certainly feel free to call our information line. And I don't know how to explain this. I don't know. She can't even explain it. All I can tell you is we started out the hour with a... I know you watch the show and you wonder what's rehearsed, what's produced. That was a very real moment for me, and I'm pleased when it happens for our guests. Thank you so much for being here. Take care.
Over him. We understand. We understand. We understand here. We get, yeah.
What have we uncovered?
What?
We found some answers?
Well, not real. I'm not sure. I have to check with my... could be my grandfather, but...
it could be your grandfather there.
He's talking about your glasses. Do you understand changing your glasses?
No, a few years ago I
No. He's talking about the prescription. Talking about changing the prescription.
And about a year ago. Yeah.
Right. And he's laughing about this. He just says, tell him I'm with him. I watch him. I watch over him. I'm his guiding light, and he really just wants you to know that. He calls you his boy. Over and over, he calls you his boy. He just says, he's my boy. He's my boy.
Were you close with your grandfather?
Yes.
Yes. And how long has he been gone?
I have two grandfathers that are deceased. One, my father's side died about 5 years ago, and the other died about 20 years ago.
Uh-huh.
So I don't remember much about my grandfather that died.